Hello everyone, welcome back to the session on your process synchronization. So in this particular session, we will be discussing about the next topics relevant to your process synchronization. So in the previous session, we discussed something related to your, right? We discussed about something called as a very important topic, something called as semaphores. And we also discussed that what do you mean by semaphore? It is nothing but it's simply an integer variable. In a programmatic point of view, it is simply nothing but it is an integer variable which can be accessed with the help of two different operations here. Something we discussed about something called as weight, and then we discussed about something called as signal. And we also seen the traditional representation of this particular operations, weight and signal. And apart from that, we also discussed this particular weight and signal using a different kind of parameters. Like, yes, isn't it? So I hope you people are very much aware with this particular concept, weight and signal operation. We have implemented using, when we started implementing traditional way, we have written something like this, I guess, if I am not wrong, weight, capital S. So while S is less than equal to zero, so we will be performing something like do nothing. Nothing, simply busy weight. Else S minus minus. This is what we did, right? This is the traditional way. Then we have something called a signal, S. So S plus plus and then. And then when we implemented this, we modified this particular weight and signal to overcome this busy waiting. We discussed that we have a same problem. It has a problem, something called as busy waiting, similar to your mutex lock, whatever we discussed. We also call it as a spin lock. So that problem was actually existing. Okay, if you don't So spin lock modified this particular weight operation and signal operation, and that is what we have seen it. So in the coming session, okay, and based on that, we are going to discuss about the different problems associated with this. So today's session, the main focus will be on something called as the classical problems on synchronization. Classical problems on synchronization. Here, we will be discussing three different type of problems. We actually going to discuss about three different type of problems. The first one you are already familiar with, something we call it as bounded buffer problem. Bounded buffer problem. I think if people know this we have discussed in the first session of this particular process synchronization, that is in something called as producer consumer problem. Okay, so the same problem we are going to take here. So that problem we are going to solve it using semaphores. The next one, what we have after bounded buffer problem, is the reader by writer problem. So the next one what we have is reader writer problem, and third one, the famous one what we have, is the philosopher. The philosopher, okay, the dining philosopher problem. See, so these are the three problems what we are going to see, and these three are very much important. And whenever a particular programmer develops a new solution, okay, whenever a particular programmer develop a new solution for this particular process synchronization, now these three problems are actually applied onto that particular solution to test it whether this solution, whatever we have defined it, effectively able to overcome these particular problems or not. If it is able to overcome the problems, then this becomes the best solution and it can be directly implemented in our systems. So this is the way how exactly they do. Whenever a new programmer comes or a new program or new algorithm is developed for this particular process synchronization mechanism, that particular algorithm or the program, whatever has been developed, that will be implemented on these three famous problems. And if it is able to solve these three problems, then definitely it is one of the best solutions that has been designed, and that will be directly implemented in the coming versions of your operating system. This is the way exactly they does it. Okay, so that is the main, that is the best part, as well as that is the importance of these three particular algorithms, what we are going to see in the coming session. And we will also provide, not only we'll discuss the problems with respect to these three, we are also going to provide solutions using semaphore to these three particular problems. And after that, that will be the session. So basically, as I told you, that we are going to come across three different types of problems here. The first is bounded buffer, reader-writer problem, and dining philosopher problem. Let's go ahead with the bounded buffer problem. Okay, let me explain it, then I will show you the presentation here. Well, actually, it's not new that what we are going to discuss here. We already discussed in the first session itself. I think you people are aware with your producer consumer problem, right? So in this we said that we discussed something like the producer will keep on producing an item, right? The producer will keep on producing an item, whereas coming to the consumer keeps on consuming the item the producer produces. Right? So here the producer can keep on producing a new item and the consumer will consume the item which is produced by this particular producer. So basically we said that where this producer is producing item that we have to store somewhere. So we actually said that we are going to store it in some kind of a buffer. We are actually allocated some space to this particular producer to store the information, and this is what we are calling it as buffer. And this buffer is shared by both, by the producer as well as by the consumer. Now, this buffer, again, we classified into two types. Something, if you remember the previous topic, something like unbounded and another one is bounded. Right? So, I think unbounded is nothing but limitless. There is no limit. The producer can keep on producing the items. As many as he want, he can keep on producing until the system runs out of the memory. Till then, he can produce the items. Like for example, your system consists of 500 GB. Then the producer can keep on creating the items until this 500 GB is occupied. That is what he means to say. And same way, whereas coming to bounded here, that is limit. Means not all the 500 GB we will be allocating to one particular process or one particular producer. Rather, we will provide only limited versions, like something like 20 MB or 20 GB. Okay, so in this way, we are going to produce the items. Well, when we were discussing about this, we had a problem associated with this particular bounded buffer. Yes, this is what we had a problem with the bounded buffer that we have discussed. Means what he means to say, when the producer and consumer are simultaneously trying to perform an operation on this particular buffer, whatever the variables we are going to get, the data, whatever we are going to get from this, when these two producer and consumer are simultaneously executing it, that data is not accurate because there is no synchronization. That is what we discussed in the first session of your process synchronization. To overcome that, we have seen the diagram. I mean, we have provided solution, something we use some counter variables. And using that counter, we just try to make sure that one at a time can execute the statement. And based on that, we are able to provide the synchronization. Okay, but okay, that is the normal representation of this producer-consumer problem. But now what we are going to do is, using semaphores, we will try to provide, okay, a perfect solution to this particular bounded buffer problem. This is the problem here. And this problem is associated with your producer-consumer problem. Okay. So let me erase it and show you how exactly it's going to work. So definitely we are going to use some kind of data structure here initially, since we are going to implement using semaphore the solution. So we need to use some kind of data structure. So that is nothing but we need to declare some variables and everything. So that we are going to see. So here the first thing what we are going to do is we are going to take a buffer. And the size of the buffer we are going to take as n. Means limited. Since we are talking about bounded buffer, bounded is nothing but here, we are calling it as the limit, right? So since we have a limit here of how many we can use, so I am taking here as n size. The size of a buffer what we are taking is n. Now here, apart from that, we are going to use one more variable, okay? So we call it as mutex. We are calling it as mutex, and that is what we call it as a semaphore. And I think you people know about semaphore. What do you mean by semaphore? It is a integer variable. We have already discussed. So that's why I'm directly calling it as variable. Don't get confused. Mutex is a variable. When I'm saying, that means it's a semaphore. So mutex is a semaphore that we are going to use. And why we are using this variable here is nothing but this variable is going to provide the mutual exclusion. Means at a time only one process. Okay, at a time only either the producer or the consumer is going to access that particular buffer. And initial value of that particular mutex will be 1. Okay. And then we have something called as, apart from that, we are going to take one more item here. And that item is something we are going to take is mutex. After that, we are going to take empty and full. Okay. So apart from semaphore, actually within this particular bounded buffer problem, going to take semaphore. To take only semaphore, we are going to take three semaphore. Among these three semaphore, one semaphore is for performing, entering into critical section, and that is what we are calling it as mutex. So when a process has to enter into critical section to perform the operation, it is going to use mutex. Apart from that, it is having an additional two more semaphores. And what are those semaphores? One is what we call it as full, another is what we call it as empty. And this full, we have actually initiated to zero, and empty represents n, the n number. So initially all the variables are, I mean, all the slots are empty within a buffer. So that's why we are representing with n. Full represents on how many slots have been occupied. So initially all the slots are empty, so we are representing that with zero. Okay, so let me show you the diagrammatic way. Here it is. So I think it is clear now. Int n we are using. N is nothing but it is the size of a buffer. And mutex equal to 1. This is a semaphore what we are using. We are using three semaphores here. The first one is mutex, represents mutual exclusion. And this is used for entering into the critical section. For a producer to enter into critical section or to a consumer to enter into critical section, this is a semaphore we are using. Then what about empty and full? Well, these two are used for representing the count related to, these are used for representing the count that related to the number of empty and the full buffers. So how many buffers are empty, or whether how many buffer size is full. Means for example, a buffer, I'm taking n equal to 5, means there are 5 slots, 1, 2, 3, 4. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So how many are empty here and how many are full? Isn't that? Basically, programming point of view, buffer is nothing but it is an integer variable. So I'm taking 4 integer variables. Among them, 3 integer variables are most crucial. One is normally used for representing the size of that particular buffer. Now, using this particular semaphore, this is the programmatic view, what I'm going to represent here. Now, if you see here, this is the problem related. So this is related to your producer. So whenever the producer produces an item, he want to place it in your system, he is going to use this. And whereas coming to consumer, this is related to your consumer here. So whenever consumer want to consume an item, it is going to use this particular code. Okay. Now if you see here, let me explain this. So do produce an item. So the producer is going to produce a new item. Before this particular, so let us take a buffer here. Like size of 5. I'm taking a buffer of size of 5. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay, this is a buffer I'm taking with the size of n. N equal to 5. So whenever a particular producer, so initially what is the value of mutex we have? 1. Means it is available. Then we have full. So full is initially 0. Empty is equal to n. That is nothing but the size. So size is nothing but. So let us suppose now producer is actually executing. He created a new item. He want to enter into this. So what he will do first, initially he will execute a wait to determine whether this buffer is full or empty. That is going to determine it. I think for wait, you know, the I am going to use the traditional one here. So traditional, you know, what is the code we have for wait operation? Wait while s is less than equal to 0. So busy waiting, or else s minus minus. Okay. So this is what we have. What about signal? Signal, capital S. This is the traditional I am using. But actually you should use the previous one. But this is only for your explanation, for understanding purpose. I am using this one, and using this also we can represent it. So that's why I am showing it. So first thing, what is going to do? Weight of empty. So here it is value of empty. And this is means the system doesn't have to wait. Which system? The producer. The producer doesn't have to wait for why because the critical section is not busy right now, it is free. Then what is going to do, it is going to find out whether can I enter into the critical section or not. So weight of mutex, so what is the value of mutex? We have 1. Again the value 1 is transmitted here. Now we will check 1 is less than equal to 0, condition fails. So what it is going to do, s minus minus. So 1 minus minus is equal to 0. You are getting my point? So 1 minus minus means 0. Means what is the value of mutex now? The value of mutex becomes 0. And what about empty? Since there is a space available, so empty becomes minus minus. So 5 minus 1, empty becomes 4. Means out of 5 slots, one of the slot is occupied now. Now what happens, the system using mutex, since mutex, since the producer has entered into the critical section, the value of mutex becomes zero. Now the producer is in this particular section, critical section. Now what he is doing, he is going to add that new item into the buffer somewhere here. Let us suppose one, he has created one, I am placing here. Okay, now after that what happens, once he completes it, he is going to call the signal. So signal when is calling mutex, now what is the value of mutex we have here? Zero, right? Now the mutex value will become one. When you are giving signal, what we are doing here, signal zero. So what we are doing, incrementing the value, so s becomes one. Remember now, the value of s is now one. Next, signal full. So full will be incremented. So what is the initial value of full we have here? See here, zero. Now here, after performing this, the full becomes one. You're getting it? I hope it is very clear how it is working. Now let us suppose in the next step, again the producer is performing the operation. Consumer did not start consuming it. The immediate next step is performing the same operation. Show you up. Okay, I'm erasing this part. Okay, I'm erasing this now. Let's see, the producer is now producing it. Now since producer is producing it, so what we are going to get? So again, he is calling weight of empty. Now what is the value of empty right now we have here? The latest value what we have is 4, because one of the slot is filled. So 4. So 4 again will be transmitting here. So 4 is less than equal to 0, condition satisfied. So 4 minus minus. Now the value of empty becomes 3. Because the second slot is actually occupied now, only three empty slots are available. Then again it is calling weight of mutex. The producer is calling weight of mutex. So what is the value of mutex we have initially here? S equal to 1. So we, 1 is there, means that critical section is free. Now the system will enter again into S minus minus. Now the value of S becomes 0, means mutex becomes, the value of mutex here again becomes 0, and the system, producer is entering into critical section. What is going to do? He is going to add the items into that particular slot. How he is going to do so, he is producing, you know, he is adding that item. Once he has completed adding it, he will come and he will call signal of mutex. So again, what happens, signal of mutex, S plus plus. So what is the value of mutex we have here? 0. Now here this becomes 1. So again, the mutex value S is equal to 1 now. Then comes signal of full. So full will be incremented. Now full, initially the value of full was 1. Now this has been 2. Now full is terms we have right now, empty is equal to 3. So there are 3 empty slots we have, whereas coming to full, full is 2. So there are 2 full spaces. 2 slots have been filled up by this particular producer. And what about the mutex value we have? Mutex is equal to 1. So remaining, okay, I will erase it up. So please remember this, I am going to erase it. Okay, so okay, now let's see. Empty, how many we have? Empty is equal to how many we had? 3. Empty slots. What about full? 2 slots have been filled. What about the mutex value we had? 1. Okay, let me draw the diagram here. 1, 2, 3, 4. So we have placed 2 items here. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So 2 have been filled, 3 are empty. Now let us suppose, now consumer started consuming it. So what he will call first? Weight of full. So he will try to find out whether there is an item present in this particular buffer or not. It is trying to determine. So what is the value of full we have here? 2. So that we are transmitting here. So weight, I think you people know what we need to do, weight of 2. So since 2 is less than equal to 0, condition fails. So 2 minus minus, so 1. So what is the value of full right now we have is 1. Means one of the slot is going to be consumed by the consumer. Which slot? The second slot. Now weight of mutex. So before entering, means starting consuming that item, it has to enter into the critical section. So for that it is executing weight of mutex. So mutex value is 1. So that 1 we are passing. So weight of 1. So 1 is less than equal to 0, condition fails. So 1 minus minus. So that becomes 0. Now the mutex value is 0. Now the system can enter into the critical section. Okay, if any other process comes, the mutex value will be 0. That process cannot enter into the critical section. Like for example, producer want to keep an item. What is the value of mutex? We have 0. Means consumer is in the critical section. So producer has to wait until this value becomes 1. He can't enter. Okay, so at a time only one can execute. So he is entering into remove an item from the buffer. So what is the item he is removing? 2. And after that, what he is doing after consuming that item, he is coming out. So he is calling signal of mutex. So again, he is calling mutex with the mutex value will become 1. Now, since the value has become 1, the producer can perform its operation. It can start executing its operation. And after that, he is calling signal of empty. So signal of empty means empty value increment. So empty is equal to 4. Means there are 4 empty slots right now. Obviously, we have 3 empty slots. This item is consumed. So how many we are left with? 4 empty slots are available. So this is the way it is going to perform. And once this is done, again, producer can produce, consumer can consume. This is the way how we are performing synchronization. You can see simultaneously, both are not able to perform operation. Like when this producer is producing, consumer is not consuming. You can see that, right? At a time, only one of them can enter into this particular critical section and perform the operation. Not simultaneously, both can perform the operation. So that is the best part of this particular semaphore. So using semaphore, we are providing a solution. This is the solution what we have provided. Well, in this, you people, when you are implementing in a programmatic point of view, you people have to write the logic here. Okay, this dash, whatever you're seeing, here we need to write the logic. This is only a template that is given to you so that you can understand how it exactly works. And the next problem that we have, the very important problem related to your synchronization is reader-writer problem. Okay. In with this reader-writer problem. Processes. Let us suppose P1, P2, P3, so on up to PN. Okay. All these processes are congruently or simultaneously trying to access this particular database. Now, well, obviously, all these particular processes are not going to access it for one particular thing, right? Some processes might be using it for reading purpose, and some may want it to update the database. Update. Update is nothing but reading as well as writing, isn't it? So not all processes are going to perform the same operation. Some might be accessing it for performing read operation. Some might be using the database for performing updation, something like, you know, reading as well as writing. Now, when you talk about this particular, so we will be classifying these processes, these end processes. We are actually going to classify them into readers. Okay. Those who are reading, we call it as readers. Readers process. And those who are performing updations, we call it as writers. Readers as well as right. Now, so remember this, we are going to classify them in reader and writer. But if, let us, now here, the thing what we need to consider here is that, now if n processes or n readers want to access this database simultaneously and perform the operation, do we have any problem here? Can we face any kind of problem? Yes, of course, we are not going to perform any kind of problem here because all these n processes, let us suppose you people are 54. 54 students are accessing this data only for reading purpose. Means they are not performing any kind of modification. They are simply opening that particular database and reading the data. That's it. So that means that there will not be any problem. But let us suppose that if the 54 students or the 54 people or the users are trying to access this particular database for performing write operation at the same time, then what is the situation? Can anyone tell me? Definitely it is going to be a, one of the weird kind of database. Why? Because all the 54 students simultaneously will try to modify. Simultaneously they will try to modify this particular database. Then what will happen? Obviously whatever the database is there, that will not be in a structured format. Okay, everything will be up and down and you know, everything a mix and match kind of situation. So there will not be a proper thing. So there the problem is, this is what the problem here. So whenever readers, multiple readers are performing the operations, we don't have any kind of problem. But when the write operations of database coming. So the problem is that there is no consistency in the data. There will be a no consistency. There will be a no consistency in the data with respect to your database. So that is a big problem. How we can overcome this problem? Well, yes, we do have a solution with semaphore, and that we are going to represent it. But before representing that, Okay, let me clear this. Let me show you the presentation, and then I'll show you. There are actually two different type of reader writer problems we do have. Let me show you so that you can get an idea about it. Okay, fine. So here you can see that we have a reader and a writer. As I told you, reader will only read the data set. They do not perform any kind of update. So definitely if n users or n process readers or n users or readers are trying to access the same database simultaneously, we will not have any kind of issues. But whereas coming to writer, both read and write. So whenever these are performing readers, so n users or writers are performing an operation on a database, then definitely a chaos will arise. So that is a big issue. To overcome that, we are using semaphores. Using semaphores, we can perform the operation. For that, what happens? So reader will have a separate kind of structure. Same way, writers will have a separate kind of structure. Well, basically, in the previous problem, we have used the same. We are in the previous problem, that is bounded buffer problem, we used three semaphores. But in this case, we are going to use only two semaphores. That's it. So RW underscore mutex, which is initialized to 1, mutex, which is initialized to 1. This is similar to the previous one. And then we have an integer variable read count initialized to 0. Now let me explain them. What do you mean by this? Read count is used to determine the number of users using the database. Number of users using the database for read purpose. Okay, so number of users using the database for reading purpose is what is represented. Suppose there are 5 users, so another person comes, 6th user is coming, then the read count initially was 5, now it will become 6, so it will be incremented. Whereas coming to mutex here, I think you people are familiar, same functionality with respect to the previous what we discussed. So mutex is mutual exclusion. So whenever a process enters into the critical section to perform the operation, mainly for writers. Okay, so this one is used, mutex. And after that, even readers also, whenever they want to enter into critical section for performing operation, this mutex is used. This RW mutex, what you are saying is nothing but for writers. This is the one we use it for writers. Yeah, RW is nothing but read-write. So writers perform both read and write, and that's what we are using. Now this mutex is essentially important whenever a writer is entering into a critical section. Because when a writer is entering into critical section, no reader should be allowed to enter into the critical section. Same way, no writer should be allowed to enter into the critical section when one of them is executing it. So that's the reason we use this protect mutex. So two mutex we are using here. Let me erase it. So we are using two mutex here. The first one, what you are seeing, RW mutex. This is for writer. And apart from writer, it is used for the last and the first reader. This mutex is applicable to all the writers which are going to perform the operation. Apart from that, it can also be applicable to the last and the first reader. Okay, why? Because see, whenever a writer enters, the last reader, whoever is there, that should be associated with this. Because after that, no other reader should be allowed. Because the writer is going to enter into critical section and perform the operation. Same with the first reader. So whenever the first reader is entering, we need to associate with respect to that particular thing. So this is associated. Whereas coming to the mutex here, this is with respect to all the readers, including the first and the last. First and last, even middle, whatever the readers are coming, that is, this is associated with that. Read count is used to determine the number of users or the readers are performing the read operation. Okay, now this is a diagram with respect to your write process here, which is very small. Only reading process will have a little bit code, much code, but writing is very simple. So whenever a writer wants to perform an operation, he will call wait operation RW mutex. It will find out whether it is a, so initially it is 1 now. So let us suppose the first writer is performing operation, the mutex is available. So this value becomes 0. So RW mutex, after executing wait function, it becomes 0. Why? Initially the value of RW mutex is 1. So 1 minus minus 0. Now the process will enter. The writer will enter into the critical section. He will perform the writing operation. Once the writing is performed, he will call the signal. Now in signal, what is the value we have? Incrementing RW mutex plus plus. So what is the value we have? 0. Now this will be incremented to 1. So whenever next process comes, he can access and he can perform the operation. Very simple. But the main problem that comes here is related to your writer's problem. Okay, writer's problem here. So this code, whatever you're seeing here, is with respect to your consumer process. Who is going to consume? Okay, not consumer here, writer. Sorry, it's my mistake here. I did not. So this is a reader's problem. Reader's process. Which process? The processes which want to perform the read operation. This is the code for that. So before entering into it, they have to first execute mutex, wait of mutex. And once that mutex is available, then they are going to increment the code. Read count is incremented because that particular process is been added into the processes which are present. For example, 5 processes are reading. A 6th process came. So 6th process, when he executed this, he got the chance to enter into the critical section. So read will be incremented. Now the read value becomes 6. So 6 processes are reading that particular database. Now it will check if the read count is equal to 1, wait for RW mutex. If it is a first reader, as I told you, RW mutex can be implemented for the first reader and the last reader. So if you see here, 6 is not the last reader. If it is not equal to this, it can simply skip and it can come to signal mutex. So it will release. It will release the mutex. So initially the mutex value becomes 0, now it becomes 1. And it will enter. Means what reader, as I told you, simultaneously multiple readers can operation, right? They are not, so they don't have to make this mutex. I mean, they don't require any kind of lock. They can simply enter into this particular critical section. But if they are not modifying this mutex, what will happen? If another reader is coming, he will get the value of 0. So 0 means he may not be able to enter into that critical section. That's the reason before entering into the critical section, the reader will release that particular semaphore, mutex semaphore. So that if a new reader operator is coming, reader process is coming, he will get the value 1, then he will make it as 0. He will, before entering into it, again he will make it as 1, and then he will perform the operation. This is the way the whole scenario works. And if you see here, once this particular reading operation is completed, then it will be executing wait of mutex. It will release the mutex again. Then the read count will be decremented. Initially it is 6. One of the processes left, the number of processes is 5. So if the read count is 0, means this is the last process. Then again it has to signal RW mutex. Okay, as I told you that RW mutex is implemented for first and last. So this is what it is checking here. If it is the last one, then it has to execute signal. Else signal mutex. Okay, if this is not the case, simply skip and execute signal mutex and come out of it. So this is the way how your reader process is going to perform this particular operation. Okay, sorry for this. This is actually related to your reader. You can see the reader is having much more data because it has to make sure that whenever a writer is coming, the last reader is not entering into it if access is given to it. So that's what I'm going to explain here. So actually this reader writer problem, there are variations we do have. We have two variations. First variation, we call it as the first reader writer problem. In this, what he says is that no reader will be kept waiting until the writer has permission. Means until the writer process is given the permission to enter into the critical section, till then no reader process should be stopped from entering into the critical section. That is what he means to say. The next one, what we have is second variation. We call it as second reader writer problem. In this, what he means to say is that once a reader is given a permission, once a writer is given a permission to enter into the critical section, he has to perform the write operation as soon as possible. Means he should not wait. Means no other process should be allowed to enter into the critical section, whether it is a reader or writer. And this particular process should complete execution as soon as possible. That comes under second variation. And here, both of these particular problems, what we have discussed, actually results in a something called as starvation. They have a backlog here, first reader and second reader, that is starvation. For example, once a writer is entering into the critical section, the reader, we are going to stop that reader from entering into critical section. So what happens? The reader is simply starving there. Same way here also, when reader should not be kept. So whenever the permission is not given, the reader should not be stopped from entering into critical section. Then the writer may not be able to get a permission because readers will keep on entering into the critical section. So the writer may not get a chance to permission to enter into critical section. So the writer is starving here. Same way here, the reader. In this case, the reader is going to starve. So that is the problem we are facing here, and that is solved using this particular reader writer problem. Yeah, whatever the problems you are facing, these two, that is what the problem is getting solved using this particular reader process and the previous slide, what you have seen is write a process. So this is all related to your reader writer process. And the next one, the most important what we have is dining philosopher problem. Okay, let me explain this, what exactly this consists of. Okay, let me show you the diagrammatic view. Yeah. Well, here if you see here, I'll simply explain in a story format. Okay, there are actually five philosophers we do have. Okay, there are five philosophers we are having here. And these philosophers are actually, the task of these philosophers is only two things, thinking and eating. Only these are the two things they do usually. The first thing they are going to do is thinking, and the next thing what they are going to do is eating. So we have a round table here, and this round table is surrounded with five chairs for the five philosophers. Okay, and this philosopher will sit in this table and they'll keep on thinking and eating. So on this table, this is going to have table. In the center, we have a rice bowl. And there are five chopsticks that are important here. Five chopsticks. Now, whenever a particular philosopher feels hungry, he will first pick up the left chopstick. Remember, he will pick up the left chopstick first, then he will pick up the right chopstick. When both the chopsticks are available, then only he can start eating. For example, this is a philosopher, he is feeling hungry. He will first find out whether this chopstick is available or not. If it is available, he will pick up first. Then he will find out whether the right chopstick is available or not. If it is available, he will pick up and then he will start eating. Once he completes eating, he will stop. He will place that particular chopstick there and then again he will start thinking. Same way if you talk about this particular philosopher, so first he will try to pick up the left chopstick. If it is available, then the right one, then start eating, then he will keep it up. Same way all the five philosophers are going to do. Once they are completed it, they'll keep the chopsticks and again they will start thinking. It's very easy, na? Only two things they have to do, eating and thinking. But there are some conditions. The way they have to eat, we have a condition. What is the condition is that at a time, the philosopher can pick up only one chopstick. Means, for example, this is a philosopher feeling hungry. He can pick up the left chopstick first. And when he's picking up this, he cannot pick up this one. Only this one he has to pick. Once this is present in his or her hand, then he can start picking up the next chopstick. So at a time, only one chopstick he can pick up. And the next condition is, she cannot pick up a chopstick that is already in the hand of a neighbor. For example, when he started picking up, this is available, he has simply picked it. But when he starts picking up this particular chopstick, this is present with this particular philosopher. So then he has to wait until this philosopher is placing the chopstick again. Till then, he cannot eat. He has to wait for this particular chopstick available. That is what he is saying in this case. So when the philosopher is having both the chopsticks at the same time, then only she can start eating without releasing the chopstick. So obviously, as I told you that this particular philosopher cannot eat until this is available. Once this is available, he will pick up, both the chopsticks are available, he can start eating it. So that is what the thing we have related to your dining philosopher. Well, there is no problem here. The problem will come now. What is the problem here is that, okay, till now I have explained you one by one. That this philosopher is hungry, he is eating this. What if all the philosophers, five philosophers are hungry at the same time? What will happen? Let us suppose this philosopher is hungry, he will pick up this particular chopstick. Okay, at the same time, all of I am telling you one by one. Okay, let me erase it. I am telling you one by one, but actually all are simultaneously performing the operation. So let us suppose this is the first philosopher we have, first one. He is feeling hungry at the same time, he has picked up the left chopstick. The second philosopher is hungry at the same time, he picked up the left chopstick. Third philosopher is hungry, he picked up the left one. Fourth is hungry, picked up the left one. Fifth is hungry, he has picked up the left chopstick. Now they have to get the right chopstick. Now he will look for this particular chopstick, but this is already present with this fellow. Now this guy, he is trying to pick up the next chopstick, this one. But this is already present with this particular philosopher, and then he is trying to pick up this chopstick, but this is already present with him. And this he is trying to access this one, this is present with him. He is trying to access this one, this is present with him. Now what happened? None of them will get the right chopstick. Condition, the chopstick, no one will be able to eat there, means they will be able to appetite, means they will be able to satisfy their appetite. So all they'll be starving. That condition is what we call it as. I think we already discussed in the previous session, deadlock or starvation. All will die because they are not going to leave the left chopstick. Everyone is not going to leave the left chopstick until they are getting the right one. And no one is going to give the right one. Means that is the left chopstick of another process. So definitely they are going to be staying like this only, hungry. Finally they will starve, and that is a deadlock situation we call. Finally all the philosophers will in a dead state. Now here, that is the problem. Now you people have to overcome this problem, that these philosophers should not enter into a deadlock state, neither starvation. So that is what the solution we need to provide for this particular problem. That is the dining philosopher problem. So for that, what we are going to do is, we are going to, so whenever, okay, these are the statements related to it. Now I am going to provide you the solution. Solution is very easy, deadly. So here the data, like the data structure, what we are going to use is only one semaphore we are going to use, but it is a of type array. So there are five semaphores within this. We have five chopsticks. The problem where we got it, where is the problem we actually associated? This chopstick. So we have taken that in a format of a semaphore five. And we'll make sure that at a time only one, no two process, I mean, philosophers are trying to access the data simultaneously. Now this is the diagram we do have with respect to this. So whenever a particular philosopher try to access it, it will perform. Since both the chopsticks are required, so one at a time, left and right. So first the particular process, whichever is hungry, will execute weight of chopstick of I. So this is for left one. Then for the right one, it is going to execute the weight of chopstick I plus 1 person 5. If both are available, then only it can start, enter into the critical section and start eating. Once it has completed start eating, what it has to do? It has to leave the chopstick again one by one. So first left, then next. So signal, chopstick of I, then signal. So this is for the left one, this is for the right one. And then it will come out. Then another, then again it will, what is the remainder section? It will keep on thinking. Once eating is done, thinking. Then this process will keep on repeating. If the next process is coming, it will first execute the wait for the chopstick for left one. If the left one is available, then it will write for the, it will try to find for the right one. Well, there is a small assignment I'll give you here. You just do a working part here. You use this five. We have how many chopsticks? Five, na? Just try to work on it, whether he is getting the right one or not. For example, this is the first philosopher. This is the first. So this is the left chopstick. Okay, this one you got it here. Fine. What about this one? You execute this and see whether you are getting the same one or not. I mean, this chopstick you are getting or not, you people work on it. You will find it out. Well, I will explain this concept. Okay. Okay. I'll explain this entire concept in your monitor's concept. So right now, you do the working part of this particular, whether you're getting, so this is the left hand thing, this is for the right one. You just find out whether you're getting the right chopstick or not. For example, so if it is two, okay, this philosopher is getting two, then you should get the right chopstick as one. So if you're getting here something, weight of chopstick as two, this should be one. So whether you're getting it or not, you just try to find it out. Okay, you just start, do the working part so that you can get it. Since you people are good familiar with your programming logic, so you just want you people to work on this. So this is the way, okay, in monitors, I'll explain you one by one how exactly this works by taking a small example. For timing, you people can execute this. Okay, so this is the way how it is going to perform the operation. Very easy. Remember this, we are going to provide a solutions using monitors also, and there we are going to use this code. So please don't forget, work on this. So this is for the left, this is for the right, left, right. Okay, or maybe it may be like vice versa also, right, left, that depends. So that's what I want you to work on it. Okay, now here the problem what I discussed, that is what represented here, deadlock situation. As I told you that if all the five philosophers are hungry simultaneously, then how we are going to perform the operation? Well, some philosophers have given some ideas here. The first one is, he is asking you, so around this round table, you maintain only four philosophers. Okay, remove this one philosopher, remove this particular ball, but remain this chopstick as it is. So there will be five chopsticks here, okay, but there will be only four philosophers sitting here. So you will not get this problem. You can work on this. You can simply work on this. You will easily identify that none of the philosophers will be starving now, because we have one additional. We have four philosophers, so we have five chopsticks. So one additional chopstick we are having. So at a time, one of the person philosopher will get two chopsticks. He will eat, he will leave it. Then remaining processors can start eating, perform the operation. So there will not be any kind of starvation or deadlock situation. Another one said that, okay, allow a philosopher to pick up the fork, only both are available. Like in the previous case, I told you, this fellow has picked up this particular left one. This one has picked up left one. He has picked up the left one. He has picked up the left one. So he has picked this. So what is saying that? If both are available, then only allow him to pick. For example, this fellow has picked up this one. Picking up this one, he will find out whether this is free or not. This is not free, so he will not pick this one. So what will happen? This fellow will get this chopstick and this one. So he will eat and he will leave it. You're getting my point? Same way, then what happened? The break. We have actually break that particular chain. So after that, what happened? This philosopher will be able to execute, means eat and leave. When he is leaving, he will eat and leave. Then this fellow also will get eat and leave, and then finally he is going to perform the operation. So this is the way. There is a second solution that has been given. The third solution is much more easier one, and somewhat something like, you know, what is saying? This is the asymmetric solution what is giving. What is saying that odd number philosophers are there now, they will pick up the left one first and then the right one. So if there are odd number, means for example, I gave the numbers 1, 2, 3, 4 and 5. Odd. So 1, 3. So this philosopher, this one and this one, they'll pick up the left one. Whereas coming to the even one, even 2, 4 and, I mean 2 and 4, they will pick up the right one first. Okay, I will explain it so that you can get a clear idea. So let us suppose this particular philosopher, one is trying to grasp. What is saying? Odd will pick up the left one. So he will pick up this one. Okay. Whereas coming to even, even will pick up the right one. So he will try to pick up this one. But this one is already present in his hand, so he has to wait. You're getting my point? Now, whereas coming to the third one, he can pick up this one. Now, since this person cannot pick this one, he will be getting this chopstick. He can eat it and he can leave it. Okay, you're getting it? So this person start. Okay. It's very easy. You will find that there will be no starvation or deadlock when we are implementing this particular second and third. First one, well, we can't implement because we require five philosophers. We are not going to implement that. But these two we can implement. Okay. So I want you people to use this, work on it and find out whether you are getting a solution or not. You will not feel any kind of deadlock situation and you will not feel something like starvation. Just work on it. And also please try to work on this particular scenario because this is required in monitors also. So there we are going to work on it. So I just want you people to work on this. Okay. So this is all for today's session, what we have. Okay. In the next session, we'll discuss about something called as monitors. And with this, we'll complete the first part of your unit 4, that is the process synchronization. Thank you. Thank you for watching. If you like it, if you like this video, please subscribe and like it up. Thank you.